Distinguished academicians, both from this and from other institutions, dear students, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and a very warm welcome to today's Institute lecture. The annual Institute lecture series of IIST Shibpur was initiated by the director, Professor Ajay Kumar Ray, in October 2014 to enrich the academic ambience of the Institute. There are six lectures in a cycle, namely the Swami Vivekananda, Acharya Jagadish Chandra Bose, Acharya Prafulla Chandra Rai, Rabindranath Tagore, Vishveshwaraya, and Ramanujan Memorial Orations. We are now in the second cycle, and today we have the Acharya Jagadish Chandra Bose Memorial Oration. Acharya Jagadish Chandra Bose was born on 30th November 1858 in Mymenshing in the erstwhile Bengal Presidency of the British Raj. He graduated from St. Xavier's College, Calcutta. He then went to the University of London to study medicine, but could not pursue studies in medicine because of health problems. Instead, he conducted his research with the Nobel laureate Lord Raleigh at Cambridge and returned to India. He then joined Presidency College as a professor of physics. There, despite racial discrimination and a lack of funding and equipment, he carried on his scientific research. He pioneered the investigation of radio and microwave optics, made very significant contributions to plant science, and laid the foundations of experimental science in the Indian subcontinent. Instead of trying to gain commercial benefit from his inventions, he made his inventions public in order to allow others to further develop his research. He was not even interested in patenting his inventions. His books include Response in the Living and Non-Living and The Nervous Mechanism of Plants. He passed away on 23rd November 1937, leaving behind a very rich legacy in the form of the Bose Institute. And today, it is indeed our very great privilege to have the eminent physicist, Professor Indrani Bose, emeritus scientist of this institute, that is Bose Institute, to deliver the second Acharya Jagadish Chandra Bose Memorial Oration. Before we proceed, may I request Professor Bose to kindly be seated at the dais. And we shall offer a flower tribute to her. Professor Dipali Banerjee, Senior Professor in the Department of Physics, IIST Shibpur, to introduce the speaker to the audience.
Distinguished guests, eminent speaker, Professor Indrani Bose, my colleagues, dear students, friends, ladies and gentlemen. I feel privileged to introduce Professor Indrani Bose and eminent scientist, J.C. Bose Institute, Kolkata. Acharya J.C. Jagadish Chandra Bose, as has been mentioned by Aparna, she pioneered the investigation of microwave optics and developed the application of electromagnetic radiation in wireless telegraphy back in 1895 in this age-old city of the then Kolkata. Later on, he bridged the physical and the biological science by discovering the similarity to electric response in living and plant cells, animals and plant cells, and inorganic substances. Professor Indrani Bose, she's a physicist currently engaged in uncovering the physical principles to understand the various biological phenomena. So for her biodata, that is curriculum vitae, I would like to present here in this presentation Professor Indrani Bose graduated from Presidency College. Then she did her post-graduation from University of Kolkata, Calcutta. Then Calcutta, PhD from Calcutta University. Then she was a research, a CSIR research associate in Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science, and joined as a senior lecturer in physics department of Bose Institute in 1987. became a senior professor in physics department in 2005. Now she's an emeritus scientist in physics department, Bose Institute. Her areas of research interests are quantum spin and many body systems, application of quantum information theory in condensed matter physics, statistical physics of complex systems, and physical biology. She has contributed significantly in the field of exactly solvable many body systems, lattice statistical models like percolation and reaction diffusion system, quantum information theory, characterization of quantum phase transitions, stochastic and nonlinear processes in cell biology, signatures of sudden regime shifts. She has got more than 100 publications. 12 students have already done their PhD under her guidance, and one will be submitting very soon. She is an elected fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore, National Academy of Sciences, Allahabad, West Bengal Academy of Science and Technology, awarded with the Sri Shakti Science Samman in 2000. She's a member of Task Force Committee on Basic Research in Modern Biology, Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, Research Committee in Physics, CSIR, Government of India, Advisory Committee, Center for Advanced Studies, Physics Department, University of Hyderabad. She's a visitor's nominee to the Executive Council in Mizoram University. Now, these things is regarding her academic and scientific achievements, these are available in the internet. But I want to share with you a few things about the personality of Indrani, which are not available in the internet. Apart from being a very successful scientist, she is a wonderful human being, very positive and inspiring, who doesn't know to find anybody's fault. And she is really an excellent academician and a scientist. I must say, and another thing is, she is not only passionate about science, she is very good in literature, traveling with a strong vocabulary. I am not at all exaggerating by saying, if I say that she may be termed as a moving dictionary. Be it any topic of debate, it's very difficult to beat Indranidhi. So I now request Indranidhi to be on dais and give her talk. The dais is yours.
So, thank Aparna for the concise biography of the Acharya J.C. Bose. It is really a rare honor for me to be invited to give the Acharya J.C. Bose Memorial Oration. I belong to Bose Institute, and like many of us, I admire J.C. Bose deeply. So I must thank Professor Ajay, the director of IIEST, for inviting me to give this talk. And this is the famous photograph of Acharya J.C. Bose demonstrating his experiment in the Royal Society, London in 1897. I begin my talk by paying homage to his memory. And Acharya J.C. Bose, he was a pioneer in interdisciplinary research. He applied the concepts and techniques of physics to characterize plant signaling behavior and response of plants to various types of perturbation. We know that he made outstanding contributions in physics. Today I am going to speak about interdisciplinary research, so I thought I should highlight the fact that he was a pioneer in interdisciplinary research. And Sir David Mott, a very well-known condensed matter physicist, he said that J.C. Bose was 60 years ahead of his time. So several of his bold ideas are now finding experimental confirmation. When he first proposed the signaling mechanism in plants, when he spoke about the ability of plants to learn, ability of plants to retain memory of what the plant has learned. Many plant physiologists of that time ridiculed his ideas, they did not believe in his ideas. But recently, lots of beautiful experiments have been carried out, which are confirming many of his predictions. Now, physics and biology, they history goes back to, the beginning of 20th century. So Albert Einstein, he commented, one can best fail in dealing with living matter how primitive physics really is. That was his comment on life. Similarly, Paul Dirac, another very well-known theoretical physicist, he said, there are at present fundamental problems in theoretical physics awaiting solution. For example, the relativistic formulation of quantum mechanics and the nature of atomic nuclei, to be followed by more difficult ones, such as the problem of life. So physicists have been thinking about problems in biology, but they thought that physics doesn't have the language, physics doesn't have the tools to address interesting problems in biology. Similarly, Erwin Schrödinger, he gave a set of public lectures for the general public titled What is Life? This was way back in 1944, and at that time, remember, nothing was known about the living system. The DNA structure was not known, how proteins are synthesized, nothing was known. But he, in his lectures, he correctly identified the features which should be associated with the living system. Similarly, there is another very well-known theoretical physicist, Freeman Dyson. So he has written a book, Origins of Life. So there are many, many examples. And A.J.C. Bose was a proponent of research without boundaries. To quote him, in the pursuit of my investigations, I was unconsciously led into the border region of physics and physiology and was amazed to find boundary lines vanishing and points of contact emerge. He also said, the excessive specialization of modern science has led to the danger of losing sight of the fundamental fact that there can be but one truth, one science which includes all the branches of knowledge. So now, what is the scenario in the 21st century? The biological research in 21st century is undergoing a paradigm shift. It's undergoing a revolution. So there is a convergence of disciplines like physics, chemistry, mathematics, engineering, and computer science in addressing interesting problems in biology. So this kind of cross-disciplinary interaction is unprecedented in human history. And in this kind of interdisciplinary research, emphasis is on quantitative studies. That you have to calculate things, you have to put numbers on quantities. Like people in the physical sciences, they do. They calculate things, they compute, they give you numbers. So that has to be done in biology. Similarly, there has to be an interplay between theoretical models and experiments. And then one should search for physical principles and universal features. Just observations won't do. In biology, often we just observe things, we report phenomena, but what is needed is look for physical principles, look for universal features. And all of interdisciplinary approaches move beyond description to prediction and control. That if you really understand the system well, you should be able to manipulate the system, you should be able to, synthesize the system. So in my talk, I'll give you a flavor of the kind of research that is going on right now. So Hartwell, Nurse and Hunt, they were awarded the Nobel Prize in 2001 for their work on the cell division cycle. So they also realized the importance of mathematical modeling, quantitative reasoning. So this is what they said. The best test of our understanding of cells will be to make quantitative predictions about their behavior and test them. We need to develop simplifying higher level models and find general principles that will allow us to grasp and manipulate the functions. Then the editor of Nature, John Maddox, at that time he was the editor of Nature, he raised the question, when on earth is biology going to become a quantitative science like physics and chemistry? So now let me start with the topic of my talk. So living matter is the best example of what is known as a complex system. For example, we know that our human body consists of millions of cells. A cell in a human body typically contains 30,000 genes. Remember, it's a large number. And genes are part of a complex network of interactions. Genes are not independent. If they were independent, the problem will become trivial. They are part of a network, and as I show, this is an interacting network. And gene expression is the most important activity in the living cell. So each gene carries a code, the genetic code. This provides the blueprint for the synthesis of messenger RNAs. The method is known as transcription. Similarly, messenger RNA provides the code for synthesis of proteins through the process of translation. So whenever I use the description gene expression, what it means is the gene is transcribed and translated to produce messenger RNA and protein respectively. And proteins work on a variety of cellular functions. Most of the essential functions in the living system are carried out by proteins. So here is a cartoon of gene expression. Here is a piece of DNA, the gene. So from the gene, messenger RNAs are being synthesized. So from one gene, more than one messenger RNA can be synthesized. Similarly, from one messenger RNA, more than one protein can be synthesized. And defective gene expression gives rise to various disorders and diseases. So whatever disease we have, whatever disorder we have, the reason is there must be some faulty gene expression. That proteins are not synthesized in the right amount at the right time. Proteins are needed for essential functions. Due to defective gene expression, the proteins are not synthesized when they are needed. So they cannot perform the function they were expected to perform. So in the absence of that function, some disease may occur. And so one of the functions of the proteins is that the proteins can regulate gene expression. So regulation can be of two types, activation or repression. So here is a network. So this is what I mean by a gene network. I told you that it has a very complex structure. The black dots, these are the nodes of the network, and they represent the genes. And there is a solid line. If there is a solid line between two nodes, that implies that these two genes are interacting. The protein product of one gene regulates the expression of the other gene. From each gene, proteins are synthesized, and I told you that proteins can also perform regulatory functions. Maybe I need the mic. I need not use the mic. Can you hear me at the back?
Yes, ma'am.
In network, the solid lines, they represent the fact that if the protein product of this gene regulates the expression of this other gene, there should be a solid line between them. And it has a complex structure. And this network describes what is known as the P53 network. So P53 is a gene which synthesizes a protein known as P53 protein. And what is the function of the P53 protein? To suppress the growth of tumors. So it is an extremely important protein. Suppose the corresponding gene is mutated, it cannot synthesize P53 proteins. So if a tumor starts growing, there is no protein available to suppress the growth. That can give rise to abnormal growth of the tumor, which ultimately can end up in cancer. So this is why I am trying to stress on the fact that gene expression is an extremely important activity. So one thing you must remember, look at the complexity of the network. But these biological networks, they were not designed by engineers. Engineers designed according to a blueprint. So how did these networks came into existence? Through millions of years of evolution. Evolution through random tinkering. So there were mutations, then due to mutations, the structure changed. If the structure is beneficial, it is written natural selection, because that is a more fit structure. And similarly, through millions of years of evolution, these networks have evolved. No one sat down with a blueprint and designed this network. This we have to remember. But the interesting fact is that biological and engineered networks share three key principles: modularity, robustness, and recurrence of circuit elements. What is modularity? That you can identify modules in the networks, within the module, the genes interact strongly, but the module interacts weakly with the rest of the network. And similarly, robustness, you know, that you perturb the network at the various types of perturbation, the function is not lost. It is robust to perturbations. And similarly, recurrence of circuit elements. Like if you look at an electronic circuit, you will find resistors, capacitors, amplifiers, etc. Similarly, people have started finding that some elements are appearing again and again. These are called motifs in the gene regulatory networks, genetic networks. So there was a famous paper in Science in 2002. The title of the paper was Network motifs, simple building blocks of complex networks. And so they looked at very simple organisms like E. coli and yeast, for which you have knowledge of the network. So what does knowledge of the network mean? The hundreds and thousands of experiments have given you the knowledge which gene interacts with which other genes. That knowledge has to come through experiments. So you have a huge database, you draw the network, then computer scientists, they develop algorithms to find out, are there motifs, certain motifs which are appearing again and again in this network. So they found out, yes, there are certain motifs. So I'll give you examples of motifs. Evolution by constant tinkering converges on the same circuit motifs. These are the different genetic network, these are the different genetic network, but they contain the same types of motifs. Now the studies have been extended to even human genetic networks. You find the same motifs. So these motifs must be having some utility, so that they are selected again and again through natural selection. So this is a beautiful review, network motifs, theory and experimental approaches. So one of the motifs is feedback loops, with which engineers are very much familiar. Feedback loops, important concept in engineering control systems. So feedback loop, a part of the output is fed into the input. Simplest feedback loop is auto-regulation. So positive feedback loop, protein promotes its own production. You have the gene, from the gene the messenger RNA is synthesized, from the messenger RNA protein is synthesized. Then protein goes and binds a region adjacent to the gene and activates gene expression. So this is a positive feedback loop. This is the output, this is fed into the input. Similarly, you can have a negative feedback loop. Protein represses its own production. See, the protein, see this negative sign here, it binds this region and represses the initiation of transcription, the first step in gene expression. So this is negative feedback. So, prominent feature of gene transcription regulatory networks, presence of large number of motifs. So, these are the examples. These motifs have been found again and again in the complex networks. So, this is called feed-forward loop. This is single input module. This is bifan. So, if you construct a random network with the same number of nodes, you will not find these motifs. So, you have to remember the genetic networks, they are not random networks. So somehow, these motifs have some important function so that the networks evolve to contain these motifs. And in this feedforward loop, there are three genes, X, Y and Z. The protein product of X activates the expression of Y, the protein product of Y activates the expression of Z, and X directly activates the expression of Z. Is it reminiscent of something in computer science? This looks like a two-input logic gate. There are two inputs, two Z, one from Y and another from X. And you can define it to be the AND logic gate, OR logic gate. If it is an AND logic gate, both of the signals have to be present simultaneously in order that Z has a finite value. So what people started doing was the following. They started trying to answer what is the function of such motifs. So I will not go into detailed history, but let me just tell you that feedforward loop, this is a feedforward loop, this is the input, and this is the AND gate. X activates Y, Y activates Z, X directly activates Z. Z receives two inputs, X from X and from Y, output. And both have to be, X and Y, both have to be simultaneously high in order that you can have an output at Z. So suppose you have a transient pulse of the input signal, X, transient, short duration signal. So in that case, Y, X activates Y, but Y is not able to reach a critical level somewhere here. It is not able to reach the level, critical level for activity. So unless it exceeds the level, it cannot activate Z. So in that case, the output is zero, because simultaneously these two are not high. But here you have a pulse of longer duration. So in that case, Y is activated above the critical threshold, so you have an output Z. So what is the purpose of this feed-forward loop? This is a persistence detector. This is a filter, noise filter. It filters out spurious input fluctuations. A well-constructed network should not respond to spurious fluctuations, spurious input signals. It should only respond to sufficiently, long duration signals. So this is one function of these feed-forward loops. Similarly, people tried to synthesize these motifs in the lab and try to find out what is their function. Suppose somebody comes from outer space and looks at some electronic circuit designed by some engineer on Earth and finds that some motif is appearing again and again. Maybe it is an amplifier, but the being from outer space doesn't know what an amplifier is. So what the being will do, it will just try to find out what are the components of the amplifier, then try to find out what is the function. So similarly, in that spirit, people try to synthesize these motifs in the lab and find out what are the functions. So this acts as a noise filter. Similarly, all other motifs will have interesting functions. So the identification of these motifs has given rise to the emergence of a new engineering discipline called synthetic biology. So there is a beautiful review by Hestie et al. In Nature 2002. So genetic control systems can be designed to correct faulty cellular mechanisms or to generate entirely new modes of behavior. Like we design an electronic circuit with known components with a specific function, similarly one can synthesize biological circuits with specific function. So this requires an integrated approach combining computational and mathematical modeling and combined with experimental molecular biology. So there has to be an integration of theory and experiments. So these two pioneering papers gave rise to the discipline of synthetic biology. If you have time, just look at the papers. They appeared in the same issue of Nature in 2000. Construction of a genetic toggle switch in E. coli, a synthetic oscillatory network of transcriptional regulators. So a switch. So in the first paper, they designed a biological switch. We know that a switch has to be bistable. There has to be two states, off and on. So off state, in the case of a biological state, in the off state, protein level will be low. Like for an electrical switch, current will be zero. And when the switch is in the on position, there will be a finite amount of current. Similarly, in this case, off state means protein level is low. This is a protein switch. And on state, protein level high. So do you understand the implication of this synthetic device? So suppose this P53 protein is missing in our cell. I told you that the absence of this protein can give rise to cancer. But if you can introduce this genetic switch in the human cell, if one can do that, and then you can switch it on so that P53 proteins are synthesized and humans are suppressed. So this kind of switch has immense application in gene therapy, in biotechnology, and people are doing lots of research in that direction. Similarly, this is another pioneering paper. They wanted to construct one protein oscillator where the protein concentration oscillates as a function of time. But I won't go into detailed description. So let me just tell you that for a bistable switch, positive feedback is essential for bistability, positive feedback. I already defined positive feedback. And repressilator, the protein oscillator is based on negative feedback loop involving three genes A, B, and C. And protein concentrations oscillate as a function of time. So here is an example of autoregulatory positive feedback loop. So we have a gene Y, protein Y is synthesized. Two proteins bind, they form a dimer. Then I told you that protein can regulate, it's a positive feedback loop. So these proteins can activate the synthesis of more proteins. So this dimer binds the region adjacent to gene Y. It can also unbind. So this is the biochemical scheme for protein synthesis. So this is the positive autoregulatory positive feedback loop. And what is the dynamics? Y is the protein concentration. So you can write down dy dt equal to Fy minus gy. Fy is the concentration of the protein. So rate of change in protein concentration, that is given by rate of increase in protein concentration minus rate of decrease in protein concentration. And let me just tell you here that messenger RNA and protein, they have finite lifetimes. They decay, they degrade. They are not stable biomolecules. So GY has this form, gamma Y. And this is the synthesis term. So using chemical kinetic schemes, you can find out the forms for FI and GY. These are the chemical reactions which are possible, biochemical events. But here, just look at this. I am trying to introduce the notion of bistability. So here, you are plotting FY versus Y and also GY versus Y. GY is a linear function of Y, so you get a straight line, the red line. And this function is plotted, this is the blue line. And see, the two curves, they intersect at 3 points. So at these points, Fy is equal to Gy. At the points of intersection, so that means dy dt equal to 0. That is, rates of change are 0. So what, see, these points describe what is known as the steady state of the system. So the protein level will no longer change if you are at a steady state. So there are two stable steady states and one unstable steady state. What do I mean by stable steady state? Once you are here, there is no rate of change. Rate of change is zero. But suppose you deviate the system, deviate the value of y from the steady state value. Suppose you are here. So at this point, the blue curve lies lower than the red curve. Then the rate of synthesis is lower than rate of decay. So here you have a dy dt is negative. Dy dt negative means that as t increases, y should decrease. So y should come back, and once it reaches this value, nothing changes. So this is called the stable steady state. If you perturb the system, if you take the system away from the steady state, it again comes back to the steady state. So using the same logic, this is also a stable steady state, and they are separated by an unstable steady state. Just remember this. That this is the example of bistability. Two stable steady states. This is the off state, protein level is low, and this is the on state, protein level is high. And they are separated by an unstable steady state. So if originally your protein concentration, the initial protein concentration is less than this critical value, then the system will always attain this low state, otherwise it will attain the high state. Just remember, two stable steady states separated by an unstable steady state. The unstable steady state acts as a threshold. If the protein level is below the threshold, you go to the off state. If it is above the threshold, you go to the on state. This is the thing we need to remember. Steady states, okay, this I already have explained. And this genetic toggle, this has a more complex positive feedback loop. There are two genes, 1 and 2. The protein product of gene 1 represses the expression of gene 2. Similarly, the protein product of gene 2 replaces the synthesis of expression of gene 1. So this is also a positive feedback loop. I won't explain why, you figure it out. It is a double negative feedback loop which is equivalent to a positive feedback loop. So this is the circuit design in the Nature paper. So physicists and engineers, they sat down, they wrote down the differential equations for this simple system. They found out the conditions for bistability, when bistability occurs. They wanted to design an electrical switch. They wanted bistability. They found out which are the parameter regions where bistability is favored. Then they sat down with actual molecular biologists and together they constructed the switch. So this is a pioneering paper. Bistability, an important concept in nonlinear dynamics. And here is an example of bistability. So steady state. Some steady state, some variable which no longer changes, it defines the steady state, and there is some parameter of the system which you are changing. See, this blue region is the bistable region. These red lines, they are the stable steady states. They represent the branches of stable steady states, and they are separated by a branch of unstable steady state. Look at the arrow directions. If you come away from a stable steady state, take the system away from the stable steady state, the system again comes back to the stable steady state. But this is a branch of unstable steady states. And on this side, these are called what are known as bifurcation points. U1 and U2, these are technical terms from the theory of dynamical systems. This is for the, called the lower bifurcation point, and this is for the upper bifurcation point. So this is like a phase transition. We are going from one region where you have only one stable steady state from a region of monostability, and at beyond this bifurcation point, you have a different dynamical regime where there are three steady states, two of them stable and one unstable. Similarly, here another dynamical phase transition is occurring at this upper bifurcation point from a region of bistability, we are going to a region of monostability. And here you see bistability is accompanied by hysteresis. What is hysteresis? Suppose you are carrying out an experiment. Here, you fix the parameter here, there is a discontinuous jump to the upper branch. Then you do the reverse experiment. Instead of increasing the parameter, you now decrease the parameter. So at this point, it does not come down here. It continues to be on the upper branch till and until it reaches the lower bifurcation point, when again there is a discontinuous jump from the upper to the lower branch. So this phenomenon is known as hysteresis. And why hysteresis is important? Can the students just tell me why hysteresis is an important feature? It promotes robustness. It promotes robustness. That if it is if it were reversible, the tiny perturbation will again bring back the system. Suppose you are somewhere here. If it is reversible, the slightest perturbation and again the system will come back to the original state. But here this will not happen. So whatever be the perturbation, if you apply a sufficiently strong perturbation so that the state variable crosses this threshold line, only then you are able to go to the upper state. So this is a hysteresis makes for a very robust design. See, nature is utilizing a very well-known concept in dynamical systems theory to have a robust functional motif. And hysteresis forms the basis of cellular memory. Cellular memory, for example, someone can apply some strong perturbation and take the system from the lower to the upper branch. Somebody applies a sufficiently strong perturbation, crosses this boundary line so that there is a switch from this state to that state. Then you remove the perturbation, but it will continue to be there. So it remembers, it retains a memory that there was some inducer which took me to the upper branch. So this is the fundamental unit of cellular memory. The cell remembers the past. There is a history dependence of a cellular phenomena. So 2000 onwards, evidence of bistability in many cellular phenomena. So here I must tell you something, that engineers and physicists, they have been developing mathematical models maybe since 1970s, etc. But their studies were ignored by experimental biologists because they said that they are simplifying biological phenomena too much and we don't understand this type of mathematics, what is the utility of that. But around 1994, a mathematical physicist, I think he was a physical chemist, John Tyson, he wrote down a set of equations which predicted that there is bistability in the cell division cycle. Cell division cycle, the cell goes through four stages. The parent cell divides into two daughter cells. Then each daughter cell goes through four stages. They again divide into two cells and so on. So he was the first one to predict that this is a case of bistability. The cell division cycle is an illustration of bistability hysteresis, but his predictions were totally ignored. But in 2003, he moved to a university where the biologists were ready to talk to him and they collaborated. And for the first time, experimental evidence was found for bistability and hysteresis, the first example in biology. And whatever theoretical prediction was made was tested in the actual experiment. And that gave rise to a revolution. People started identifying bistability in biological phenomena. And bistability is a universal theme. You can find it in all branches of human knowledge, in physics, in engineering, in economics. I have deliberately included one example, simple model of poverty trap illustrates bistability. Poverty, access to very little income. Economy, this may be economy when one single person is concerned, or a household or village, district, province, nation, whatever. So here on the y-axis, capital next year, capital this year. The straight line is the line where capital this year is equal to capital next year. This is a 45 degree line, and this sigmoidal curve, this is the actual data. That represents the actual data. So suppose your capital this year is less than this critical value. Again, see there are three points of intersection. Two stable steady states separated by an unstable steady state. So if your initial capital is below this value, so in that case, see this curve is lower than this. So in the next year, capital will be less than this year. So ultimately, you will go towards this fixed point, which is the poverty trap. But if your initial capital is above this critical threshold value, this unstable steady state value, then you will go to a state where you have a finite capital. So this example is taken from the book by Abhijit Banerjee and Esther Duflo, Poor Economics, Rethinking Poverty and the Ways to End It. And I do not have the time, but just let me point out that this bistability I told you is a universal theme. So you find it everywhere, in ecology, in economics. Economics it will be stock market price low, stock market price high. And then something changes and there is a catastrophe. From high value, you come crash down to a low value. Similarly, ecological changes. People all over the world, scientists, they are finding these examples, and bistability appears to be a universal theme in many of these examples. Similarly, I was tempted to give you another example, which appeared in Nature 2012, approaching a state shift in Earth's biosphere. Is the global ecosystem heading towards the tipping point? The tipping point is the bifurcation point, where suddenly there is a catastrophic change. So what is this? This is the curve. So these people, they surveyed data over many centuries for the ecological state of the Earth. So in the year 1700, so here you have global ecological state on the y-axis and global forcing, which is proportional to the human population size. So 1700, this light color indicates the percentage of Earth's ecosystem which has not undergone any change. And the dark green region, it represents the percentage of Earth's ecosystem which has undergone ecological change. For example, suppose you had vegetation in some place, then after 2000 years it became a desert. So that is an ecological change. That will be counted as an ecological change. So they analyze the data and they find the data fall on this upper branch. And they are predicting that probably a collapse transition can be local. If these changes go on at this point, 2045, there will be a sudden collapse to a state where the Earth's whole ecosystem has changed. See, this is totally green. So these papers have generated lots of debate, and there is a very interesting area of study. Can you anticipate such critical transitions? Can you measure quantities? Can you suggest quantities by measuring which you can say that we are heading towards a catastrophic shift? So the answer is yes. If I have time, I'll get the time. At the end, I'll tell you how this can be done, how you can anticipate the critical condition is going to occur. So let's go back to biology. So bistability, outcome of deterministic dynamics, there is no randomness. I wrote down differential equations. So once you specify the initial state, then if you solve the equations, if you solve them 1000 times, you will always get the same answer. There is no element of chance, no role of probability. But in a population of cells, if you have a deterministic dynamics in a population of cells, same protein level is obtained in each cell. Each cell has the same gene. And if you just find out how what is the amount of protein synthesized at t equal to 10 seconds, you will get the same answer because you are solving the same differential equation. In reality, biochemical events involving gene expression are probabilistic in nature. I told you that this protein molecule which regulates gene expression has to bind the DNA, the region adjacent to the gene. But suppose you have two cells. So in one, you cannot predict with absolute certainty at which time this protein will bind the DNA, because the protein will diffuse through the cell, then it will find the binding site, it will bind there. So the protein production in one cell will start maybe some few seconds earlier than in the other cell. The same thing is there, but in the second cell, the protein which has to bind the DNA, that is not available, that is still taking time, that is still diffusing towards the binding site. So most of the events which are involved in gene expression, they are random in nature, giving rise to fluctuations, which I call noise, around mean protein levels. So this is why protein number versus time. And there is an average level, and you see that there are deviations from this average level, lots of fluctuations. And these fluctuations are an outcome of random events, randomness in gene expression. And this I call noise. What I mean by noise is nothing but fluctuations, deviations from an average value. And so if you did not have any probabilistic processes, you will get a single level. But in the presence of noise, what you get is a histogram of protein levels. The stochastic gene expression, a distribution of protein levels. So there is a beautiful paper, The Cellular Hullabaloo. This came out in 2008, The Inner Life of a Cell is Noisy. So this is the mother cell, and the mother is crying. And it divides into two daughter cells through the cell division cycle. So two genetically identical cells, they are genetically identical. They are kept in the same environment, but they can behave in dramatically different ways due to noise. Because there are fluctuations in the protein levels, key protein levels. One might go dormant while the other stays active. So this is the consequence of noise. So noise can be quantified and measured in single cell experiments. So fantastic experiments are now being done. But you can take a movie of what is going on in the living cell, and you can show that proteins are not being synthesized at a constant rate. They are being synthesized in bursts, stochastic bursts. Three proteins are synthesized, then nothing happens. Then a burst of four proteins are synthesized. So, and people are measuring noise. So one popular measure is standard deviation divided by mean variance. There are lots of measures. Now my question is, can noise be a boon? Usually we are irritated with noise. We are chatting with our friend on the telephone, and if the line is noisy, we are irritated. But here I will give two examples to show that the living cell exploits noise. Noise has a beneficial role. Noise plays a beneficial role, and the living cell exploits noise to achieve certain ends. But I must tell you that the cell, through millions of years of evolution, the gene network which I spoke of, they have also developed motifs which can control noise, which can reduce noise. Like negative feedback will reduce noise. So this is the problem, that we are familiar with microorganisms, bacteria, pathogens. They cause a host of diseases for all of us. And the microorganisms cope with a number of stresses during their lifetime. So origin of stress is many. So by microorganisms, I mean bacteria, pathogens, etc., virus. The examples are lack of nutrients, harmful environmental influences, antibiotic drugs, etc. And these are tiny creatures. So that immediately the question arises in your mind, how come that they are the longest surviving species on Earth? They are so tiny that they are subjected to a host of stresses during their lifetime. How do they survive? So that now the answer, if we are beginning to find out the physical principles which are at work for this phenomenon. So microorganisms adopt a number of strategies for survival under hostile circumstances. So one such strategy, creation of heterogeneity in the microbial population. So questions, how does a population with identical genetic makeup become heterogeneous? What do I mean by heterogeneity? I told you genes synthesize proteins. By heterogeneity I mean that identical cells, identical genes, but protein levels will differ from cell to cell. Since proteins perform the essential functions, if their amount differs from cell to cell, the function performed will also not be identical for all the cells.
So the question is, how does a population with identical genetic makeup become heterogeneous, and why is heterogeneity advantageous? So variation aids in survival of cells under adverse conditions. If you have a homogeneous population, all members suffer the same fate. Either live or die. So all of them will die in this place. But heterogeneous population, a fraction may survive through adaptation. So there is a small probability that if you have heterogeneity, a small part of the population may survive under stress. And this strategy is similar to what is known as bait hedging, risk spreading in economics. So diversify your assets among multiple stocks. If you invest them in the single stock and the single stock crashes, you are gone. You become a pauper. So better invest in multiple stocks. That is, do not put all your eggs in the same basket. If the basket falls, all the eggs are gone. But distribute them. So microbes behave as single cell stockbrokers. And in fact, there is a paper in Nature that financial analysts should learn from bacteria. So in many cases, heterogeneity is in the form of two distinct subpopulations. So here is a picture. In the experiment, they were using fluorescent proteins. So if the protein level is high, those cells will be colored green, otherwise they will be colored black. So if by identical cells, they started from the same clone, same history, same environment, but two distinct subpopulations emerging. So work which we did in collaboration with experimental biologists in our institute, I told you that in order to be successful, there has to be collaboration between theorists and experimentalists. And this was a wonderful experience for me. Our language was totally different. A physicist's language is different from a biologist's language. So we had to be patient, explain to them what is bistability, why do we expect bistability. And similarly, theoreticians like me, they often come up with outlandish ideas. Do this experiment, you'll find such and such result. But the biologists will tell you this is not possible to perform. Be realistic. So we had to sort of, this was a wonderful, collaboration. There are more papers, but this is the first paper. So Mycobacterium tuberculosis is responsible for tubercular infection. In this experiment, we proved the strategy which I've explained. So we showed that noise is playing a role. Noise is creating two types of population. Noise is enabling a part of the population to survive under stress. That was the goal of this paper. So persistence in mycobacteria. Mycobacterium tuberculosis is responsible for tubercular infection. So when the pathogens enter your body, there is a tussle between host immune system and pathogens. So one strategy against pathogens is to enclose them in confined spaces. These are called lung granulomas, and starve them to death. So what the body tries to do is to enclose the pathogens in the lungs in a closed confined space, and where nutrients are not available, and starve them to death. So here the nutrient depletion is the source of stress. So there is a protein known as REL, level of REL proteins high in a fraction of mycobacterial cells. This we found out. This was our experiment. So in this experiment, stringent response was initiated. I won't go into detail, but the outcome of this response is that metabolic rates and replicative activity will become very low. Replicative means that the cell wants to divide. Metabolic processes, they require energy. But since these rates are so low, they don't need food. They don't depend on food too much. They have deliberately reduced growth rates, etc., so that their dependence on food is minimal. So these cells, where the REL protein has a high level, they survive through adaptation. They are called persisters. So this problem is a very infamous problem. Suppose somebody has tuberculosis, somebody takes some medicine, the infection is controlled and that person stops taking the medicine. But after some time, you find again the infection revives. Why does that happen? Because of these persisters. These persisters stay dormant in the cell. Quietly, they stay just inactive, dormant, growth rate is low. And they just wait for the opportune moment to revive. When conditions are favorable, they revive and infection spreads once more. So these are persisters. So the importance of being persistent, infections recur even after drug treatment. So there is one thing is that your gene, through some mutation, acne's resistance to a drug. That is a different kind of phenomenon. Here there is no genetic change, but because of this heterogeneity, this problem created by noise, a fraction of the population is able to survive. I see, if a single pathogen survives, then fine, because it will multiply and the infection will spread. So in terms of mycobacterial stringent response, two stable expression states, low rel level, high rel level, how does the switch from one state to another occur? X is the amount of rel protein, X less than XC, critical level, low rel level. This is the theme of bistability, which I have been explaining again and again. Two stable steady states, low rel level, high rel level, separated by an unstable steady state, which acts as a critical threshold value. So, and the noise induced transitions from the low to the high rel state. Just look at this. So this is the low rel level, and actually we've asked the biologists, can you show us the genetic circuit? As soon as they showed it to us, we identified a positive feedback loop. Immediately we thought, maybe there is bistability. Then we carried out single cell experiments, found two distinct subpopulations, one with low rel level, the other with high rel level. Then we measured noise, fluctuations, amount of fluctuations. And we found that the switching rate from the low to the high subpopulation is maximal, where the noise is maximal. So these things, because of lack of time, I'm not showing. So here is noise-induced transition. This is the low state, this is the upper state. So in reality, I told you there are fluctuations. These are not steady, truly steady states. So if there is a sufficiently strong fluctuation, and it crosses the threshold value, once it crosses the threshold, it goes to the upper state. So this is the noise-induced transition, which physicists are studying since a long time. And so there is an emergence of two distinct subpopulations. So two, low subpopulation starves to death or killed by antibiotic drugs, and high subpopulation persists under stress. So aim of drug therapy prevents switch to the persister state. Because if the persisters are there, no drug will act. But the way the drugs act is they attack the growing cell wall. But since the persisters have reduced their growth rates, they are almost invisible to the drug. And the drugs cannot kill them. So immediately from this study, you immediately realize the aim of the drug therapy should be to prevent the switch to the persister state. So recently, I have not written down the reference. A paper has come out in Science, the journal Science, a new breakthrough. Design of drug molecules which reduce noise. So these drug molecules reduce noise, so there is no noise in this fluctuation from the low rel level state to the high rel level state, maybe to the persister state. Because noise is so low, the persister subpopulation doesn't exist. So now you can kill the whole population with drugs. Easier said than done, but these ideas are emerging. But ultimately, I mean, they have to sort of come into reality. Similarly, there are other brilliant examples. Bacterial persistence, E. coli infection, there also you have persistence. A fraction of genetically homogeneous E. coli population survives exposure to antibiotic treatment, persistence. Similarly, okay, for lack of time, I do not go into other examples, but everywhere this theme of bistability is being utilized and noise-induced transitions from one state to the other. Similarly, another famous paper, AIDS virus, HIV-1 AIDS virus. So there also the main regulatory protein is TAT, and there is also again a positive feedback loop, and you have two levels, low TAT level, high TAT level. And in the high TAT level, infection spreads, and the low TAT level, there is latent infection. So there is no way the drugs can act on these states. So can I take 10 more minutes? So this is another brilliant example, role of noise in cell differentiation. In an embryo, when we are in the embryonic state, all cells are identical. And cell differentiation, what is cell differentiation? The stem, you have heard of stem cells. Stem or progenitor cells diversify into different cell types. So originally all cells are identical, then as the organism starts growing from the embryonic state, the cell differentiation starts. Some cells become kidney cells, some become hair cells, some become skin cells, some become pancreas cells. This is called cell differentiation. So what are the underlying physical principles that one has to understand? The stem cells, they exist in both embryo and adult tissues. And remember, all cells have identical sets of genes, all cells. So how does the different types emerge? Different subsets of genes are active in different cell types. For example, the gene which synthesizes hemoglobin protein, that is active only in the blood cell, red blood cell. The same gene is present in skin cell also, but it will stay inactive. So this is how the differentiation occurs. The same gene pool, but different subsets are active in different cell types. And remember, it divides into two possible lineages, inner cell mass, trochectogram. I will not read out the names, but through a series of binary branches, ultimately it arrives at the differentiated cells with which we are familiar, like liver, endocrine cells, blood cells, brain cells, stomach cells, etc. So at each branch point, the cell has to decide which lineage to choose. There are two alternatives, lineage 1 and lineage 2. So how does the cell decide which lineage to adopt? And cell differentiation is an extremely important process. So recently a paper came out in Nature Methods, and they analyzed the genetic circuits of different, differentiating cell types, and they found a common motif. I told you about motif. So here you have this good old genetic toggle, which I have already explained. There are two genes. The protein product of this gene represses the expression of this gene. Similarly, the protein product of this gene represses the expression of this gene. This double negative feedback loop is equivalent to a positive feedback loop. And at the same time, these genes auto-activate their own expression. That is, auto-activate their protein synthesis. So this is the motif which appears in many of these cell differentiation, many of the genetic networks governing cell differentiation. So here is a picture. This is the progenitor state, that is the undifferentiated state, when X1 and X2 are more or less equal, X1, X2, the protein concentrations. Then it differentiates into two cell types, 1 and 2. In 1, X1 is much better than X2, and here X2 is much better than X1. So two extremes of protein levels, so they are this thing. And by looking at this, you can easily understand why you are getting these different levels. See, these are replacing each other, so they cannot be simultaneously high. X1 and X2 cannot be simultaneously high because X1 is replacing the synthesis of X2. So if one is high, the other has to be low. So this is also bistable. Now the stable steady states are X1 high, X2 low, or X1 low, X2 high. And these are the differentiated states. So what is the physical principle underlying cell differentiation? So Max Delbruck, he was a physicist, but then he became a biologist. And he said bistability of biochemical networks forms the basis of differentiation into distinct cell states. Bistability, two stable steady states, they correspond to the two differentiated cell types. So Mono and Jacob, these are all Nobel laureates. Jacob was also a physicist, both of them. A two-gene motif in which the genes mutually repress each other's expression can explain differentiation. So they made this conclusion long back, before such motifs were discovered, just by simple reasoning, physical reasoning. Then Thomas, he was a mathematician, he said positive feedback loop necessary for differentiation into multiple stationary states. So what is a landscape picture? If you have to draw a landscape picture, it looks something like this. You have a space of gene expression states, so you have lots of valleys separated by a hill. If you put a ball in the landscape and just give it a push, it will go to the nearest valley. Once it reaches the valley, it will stay there. So the valleys are the stable steady states of the dynamics. And the hilltops, they're the unstable steady states. The valleys are the attractors, they are called the attractors of the dynamics. And the hilltops, so the hilltops will be stem cells, undifferentiated cells, and the valleys will be the differentiated cells. The once differentiation, the cell goes through differentiation, it should not revert back. to the original undifferentiated state. Suppose I have a black cell. Suddenly the black cell stops being the black cell and becomes a stem cell. That won't do. So there are barriers between different valleys that confer stability on these cell types. So valleys represent different cell types, hilltops represent progenitor cells. So there are many interesting possibilities if you look at the landscape. 1001 interesting problems will come to your mind. I'll just mention a few. I told you the stem cell is undifferentiated cell, then it differentiates into different cell types. So you have heard of stem cell therapy. So suppose somebody's liver cells are damaged. So in a stem cell therapy, what the doctors will do is, they will put stem cells in the liver, and they will think that given the appropriate environment, this cell will differentiate into liver cell and replace the damaged cell. And the liver will continue to function normally. But there was an ethical issue associated with this stem cell research, that these stem cells had to be picked up from the embryo. And many countries say that you cannot do this. That will be damaging the embryo, killing the embryo. But then in 2009, a fantastic thing happened. A Japanese physicist, Yamanaka and his group, he just looked at skin cells of adult rats. And then he added some proteins from outside and showed that this skin cell is converted to a stem cell. So in the landscape picture, this is something like he was able to take a ball from the valley to the hilltop. So this is called reprogramming. He got the Nobel Prize in 2012 for this brilliant discovery. And this is called reprogramming. Reprogramming of differentiated cells to induced pluripotent cells. So this is the landscape, and you can think of many engineering and physics problems like what is the optimal path from one valley to another. Then you may become more bold. You can say, I would like to convert a skin cell into a liver cell. That is, take the system from one valley to another. And so all these possibilities people are exploring. And then these people were the first to show that stochasticity, randomness, plays an important role in cell differentiation. I told you that noise is exploited in various instances. Here I'll show that cellular decision making is facilitated by noise. The cell doesn't know which lineage to choose. The noise will help it to preferentially choose one of the lineages. So back with the model of cell differentiation, I will not describe our work, but and this is the motif on which we built a mathematical model and experimental observation that this is a famous paper by Chan et al. Nature 2008 that they looked at one of the stem cell proteins and see the broad heterogeneity. The noise fluctuations, there are lots of fluctuations. If there were no fluctuation, you will get a single line. If less amount of fluctuation, you have a narrow distribution. But there is a thousandfold change in the range of these are stem cell proteins. So the cell differentiation dynamics have both deterministic and stochastic components. And I'll just show you the landscape picture instead of using the mathematical formalisms. So in the landscape picture, these are the cells, a population of cells. And because of stochasticity, they are wiggling around the valley. This is the undifferentiated, so the valley corresponding, this is the hilltop. Valley corresponding to the undifferentiated cell state. And because these are fluctuating in the valley, suppose some cell comes here where x is greater than y. Remember this motif? I was calling this previously x1, x2, now it is xy. So if x is much larger than y, at the slightest nudge or slightest cue from external signals will make it fall to a lower valley. So this is the undifferentiated cell state. These are progenitor states. Again, from them, you get differentiated cell states. So the noise is creating the potential for linear choice. So because of noise, if all of them were here, then the cell won't know which way to go, this way or that way. But because they are fluctuating in this valley, and by chance, if a cell comes to the borderline, then the slightest external signal will make it choose one of the lineages. So each individual cell in an attractor randomly wiggles around the basis of attraction. So since there are physicists and engineers present, I'm tempted to just mention the statistical mechanics of pluripotency. This is a very well-known paper. So we know that consider ideal gas in a closed container. So each gas molecule has position as well as momentum. So if there are n gas molecules, you need 3n coordinates, 6n coordinates, 3n for the position and 3n for momentum to specify what is known as the microstate. So at time t, defined by instantaneous positions and momentum of gas molecules. So numerous different interchangeable microstates realize the same macrostate. Macrostate described in terms of average properties like pressure. Here, this drawing analogy, pluripotent undifferentiated state is a macrostate. Cells are analogs of gas molecules. Protein concentrations analogs of positions and momenta. Microstate at time t defined by the sets of instantaneous protein concentrations in the individual cells. So for lack of that, I will not describe our work, but here we showed that cell differentiation is like a phase transition, and criticality is an important idea, and we could explain many of the experimentally observed features using our model. So I'll just skip this. Here is the result of our model, undifferentiated cell state, then two differentiated cell states. Here is a bifurcation. From monostability, I am going to bistability. This state becomes unstable, and I'll just keep these things. So main lesson, cellular decision making, interplay of two fundamental biological phenomena, single cell heterogeneity and gene regulation. And this multipotency, that is a pluripotency, it's still undifferentiated, is an example of what is known as the maximum entropy principle. So we have heard of the Boltzmann distribution in physics, engineering, chemistry. And so one way of deriving Boltzmann distribution is to write down the entropy. So Pi is the probability that the system exists in the microstate I. And this is the entropy. And how do you find, so the task is to find out the equilibrium distribution of Pi's. So the way to do it, if you invoke the maximum entropy principle, maximize entropy to obtain equilibrium distribution of Pi, subject to two constraints, that all probability should sum to unity, and the mean energy is fixed at that value, E average. So you can use Lagrange multipliers to maximize AC with respect to Pi, and ultimately you get the Boltzmann distribution. Z is the partition function, and the Boltzmann distribution e to the power minus beta Ei. And this is, so Pi star, this is the equilibrium distribution, where Z is the partition function. So Boltzmann distribution with largest possible entropy given the mean energy. So this maximum entropy principle is of general validity. Choose distribution, not only for equilibrium distributions, choose distribution with largest possible entropy subject to constraints. Remove a constraint, entropy increases. Gas in a cylinder confined by a piston. If you remove the piston, the gas has more freedom, it expands into the cylinder, there is more entropy. So undifferentiated cell population entropy is large. Because they have, there are no constraints. But once differentiation occurs, in one cell x1 has to be much larger than x2, in the other x1 has to be much lower than x2. So because of constraints, the entropy decreases. These are the two differentiated states. So entropy, ergodicity, and stem cell multipotency, a paper in Physical Review Letters. So summary, paradigm shift in biological research, convergence of disciplines, cross-disciplinary interaction, unprecedented. I have deliberately put in a few examples. Real-time kinetics of gene activity in individual bacteria, Golgi et al. Cell. These are pioneering papers, collaboration between Department of Molecular Biology, Princeton University, Department of Applied Mathematics, and Theoretical Physics, University of Cambridge, UK, Department of Systems Biology, Harvard University. Cellular decision making and biological noise from microbes to mammals, collaboration between Department of Systems Biology, University of Texas, Department of Physics and Biology, MIT, Department of Biomedical Engineering and Center for Biodynamics, Boston University, Weiss Institute for Biologically Inspired Engineering. Another paper, Isocost Lines, describe the cellular economy of genetic circuits. Collaboration between departments of electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, biological engineering, MIT, Synthetic Biology Center, MIT, and Harvard Medical School, Faculty of Health and Medical Sciences, University of Surrey. So, Sisters Valley Research, initiated in leading universities, research institutes of the world, and inspired by the vision of Acharya J.C. Bose, we have initiated a systems value program in Bose Institute involving physicists, chemists, and biologists. So I'll stop at this point. Thanks once again. Synthesis. Now this binding process is probabilistic in nature. So you have two identical genes, two identical RNA polymerase, but they will not bind a fraction of the second earlier that in the other gene. So if you measure the protein level, they will not be the same. So suppose you measure the protein level for 10 cells and get the average. Then you look at individual variation of protein levels around this average. You will find it does not coincide with the average, but fluctuates around the average level. These fluctuations I am calling noise because they are an outcome of
Acharya Jagadish Chandra Bose Memorial Lecture here. And Professor Aparna De Ghosh, she had arranged this whole program, and even till 2 days back, or even till today morning, I knew that I would be able to attend your program. But this is the fifth seminar in one day that I had to come and be present. So somehow, just in one day, five seminars, I think this is for the first time in my life. So I could not attend. I'm really sorry. But then, as Professor, as Aparna just now mentioned, that this was very close to my heart, and truly I wanted to understand the process of uncertainty in the living cell. And just some glimpses that I could get is, you are saying that there's an uncertainty which is essentially embedded in the biochemical process, and that uncertainty, one thing is in the process of cell division, at each of the points it happens. The form or the nature of the distribution is possibly, just when I came, you said that as usual it is Gaussian in many cases. But maybe that had there been any effort to find out, you said that if there are a large number of molecules, then automatically it gets averaged out, and possibly the noise is less prominent compared to the scenario when there is a small number of molecules. But I'm sure that the students of physics and electronics, because in electronics they are continuously coming across the different sources of noise, in fact everywhere, even in your disciplines also. And understanding noise is much more important than understanding signals. So this is one thing you should understand, and you should remember that many a times you may tend to skip the noise part, because noise, okay, we can filter it out. But so far as the signals are concerned, without noise there cannot be any signal. Every signal has got a lot of noise embedded in it. Enlightened by this talk, and you already have, I think, a video. So the video of that interview, it will be in YouTube also, so that everybody can once again listen to it. And our invitation to you, and maybe that next time, maybe that even in an informal way, would like to invite you so that you can deliver this lecture, or maybe that you can continue this one for longer duration. So on behalf of the university, once again, we extend our, you know, heart's appreciation, and we express our very best and warm regards to you. And as I said, that already she comes here, and she came here a number of times, but then we would expect you more frequently in future. Thank you very much.
For deep regard and appreciation, I would request Professor Roy to present a memento to Professor Bose.
Thank you, Bhure sir.
Here for the Acharya Jagadish Chandra Bose Memorial Lecture, and Acharya Bose was an epitome of research with where convergence of science was the theme. And what can be a more appropriate lecture today than we had in the last 1 hour or so, where it has been clearly shown how interdisciplinary research, convergence of science in the field of biological science. And during the last hour, I think we had more discussion from Dr. Indrani Bose about computer science, mathematics, biological science, than less of physics, in which department she belongs to. But there are applications of physics, no doubt. So it's a very apt lecture, and as Vishwajit was telling, she delivered it in a very lucid fashion. So everybody amongst us here was fascinated. And also, in a very candid fashion, she showed us that reprogramming of differentiated cells, the genetic switch, the P53 protein, so enormous opportunities, and that is no doubt encouraging and inspiring for the entire audience, the research scholars, the faculty members over here, to go deeper into interdisciplinary science, especially focused on biological science, because it's an enormous opportunity not only for curing diseases, but a lot of other developments and keeping us healthy, and new areas also will be explored. And I should take this opportunity to congratulate and express our thanks to Professor Dipali Banerjee, who was instrumental in finding out an appropriate speaker for this occasion, and Dr. Indrani Bose. And our director, sir, he was always an inspiration. Today he was extremely busy with 5 different seminars. But as Aparna told in the beginning, that it is his inspiration that this series of lectures, institute lecture series, was initiated. Thank you, sir, that you could finally come and spare with your few minutes talk, and also handing over the small memento to Dr. Indrani Bose. Thanks to Professor in charge of this institute lecture series, as Director sir mentioned, Professor Aparna Deghosh. She always took all the efforts, and all minute details are worked out by her only. Thanks to her, and thanks to all the audience who are present here. Thank you very much.